I am so blessed. My soul has found rest. Oh Lord, I give you thanks.
Amen. Page number 455. Count your blessings. 455.
When upon life's billows you are tempted, tossed. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost. Count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does a cross seem heavy you are called to bear?
Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be sure as the words go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. When you look at others with their plans and goals, think that Christ has promised you his wealth untold. Count your many blessings money cannot buy. Your reward in heaven or your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, Christ over all.
Count your many blessings, angels will attend. Help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Amen. You may be seated.
On that third and glorious day, God came and broke the star. turn to page 384. The Way of the Cross Leads Home. Page 3. I'm sorry? 349.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down for from cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name.
There to my heart was the blood applied.
Glory to
I don't know how many times over the last years that we've sang this song, but this phrase, there at the cross where He took me in.
Yeah.
I mean, that just kind of hit me. I don't know why this morning. It just kind of, I mean, man, that just think about what that means there. There at the cross where He took me in. Jesus Christ is in me and I'm in Him. And
yes.
Oh, man alive. Let me just sing this other verse. Let's sing the third verse. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin. I am so glad that I've entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name.
There in my heart was the blood
applied. Glory to His name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name.
There to my heart
was the blood of
stand and turn to page number 29. Page number 29. Let's all stand. How deep the Father's love for us. Page number 29.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure.
Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. We're going to dismiss the kids to children's church at this time. You guys can go ahead, but I want you to think about that phrase, his death and his resurrection. That's all we can boast in. You know why? Say, well, it's because it was for me. Sure, it was for us. You want to know a greater truth? His death was my death.
Yep.
His resurrection was my resurrection. The Bible says in Romans chapter 6, I believe it is, says that we have been crucified with him, we are buried with him, and we were raised with him to walk in newness of life. That doesn't happen at baptism, though that's what I say when I baptize people, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. But that doesn't happen at baptism, that happens at salvation. And those are two different points in time. I am thankful for it. What a great song, I love it. All the music was great. Was it Miss Cindy just now, I believe it was singing with the ensemble? He Will Hold Me Fast. When we're raised to endless life. Now that song is about 99% doctrinally correct. That's better than most songs we sing, let's just be honest, all right? There's one part in there, though. When are you raised to endless life? Is it when you die? Is it, as the song says, when he returns? Nope. You are raised to endless life at salvation. Technically, it's when Jesus was raised. not just when we get saved. Because I'm raised with him. Well, when did he resurrect from the dead? 3 days after he died. Think about that. What a great song. I love it. Not when the rapture takes place, not at salvation. We have eternal life when we get saved. Let that sink in for a minute. I think that we need to understand that not only do we have eternal life, we have abundant life. And I think we need to enjoy that every now and then, don't you? Don't you?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good thing to enjoy salvation. Work out your own salvation, the Bible says. Work it out. Don't earn it. Do something with it. Do something with it. And so many people just sit around, and as the old preachers used to say, they sit sour and soak, and or soak and sour. I don't remember the order there, but I know it's that way somehow. And they just go to heaven, and they're just like, well, missed hell. Praise the Lord. And they stand ashamed in front of Christ at the judgment seat. And I don't want to be that kind of Christian. Do you? All right, I'll take that as everybody saying no, and we'll move on. Habakkuk, that's a great book. Habakkuk chapter 3. I think I've brought you to this passage before, but I'm going to try to bring out a different thought to you today. You know, I believe that the Bible is a bottomless well of truth. I don't think we ever dive all the way to the bottom of the Word of God. With that thought, I believe that you can go to one verse and you could dive as deep as you think you can ever dive and get to the very bottom of what you think is the bottom, and then a year later go to it and study it and you think, wow, I didn't even see that before. Because it is God's truth, and our minds will never be able to understand fully all of God's truth until we get to heaven, and I think we'll understand so much more. The Bible says, you find Habakkuk chapter 3, I'll give you a minute, people are still trying to find it, because how often do you read Habakkuk, right? It's like trying to find, you know, Zephaniah or Haggai or whatever. You just don't go to that part. That's where the pages are all stuck together. You have to blow them and separate them, and there's Habakkuk, all right? That's where you find Habakkuk. Three little chapters. The more I read Habakkuk, the more I study it, the more I love this book. It is an amazing book, three short chapters. But as you find Habakkuk chapter 3, I'm going to take you to the very end, the last three verses of the book in just a second. But I want you to imagine something with me. I want you to think for just a second. Intentionally think. You ready? 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything give thanks. In everything give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In everything give thanks. I want you to think back in your time. Here's where you have to think. Think back in your life for just a little bit. And I don't know how far back you have to go. You may not have to go that far back. You may have to go further back than you think. Go back in your life, and I want you to pull out one instance in your life and your mind for just a minute. A time when you didn't understand the troubles and trials you were going through. It's a difficult time. And you didn't understand it. You didn't know all that was going on. But you've lived long enough beyond that time where now you can look back at that situation and you can see how God was working in it and through it now. Amen. Pull it out in your mind for just a second. I want you to rehearse. I'm going to give you just a few seconds. Put it in your mind. I'm thinking of a few right now in my life, but I want you to just get to one. The biggest one you can think of. Get it in your mind. A hard time. You didn't understand what God was doing. Why God would allow that to happen. But now you look at it and say, Lord, I see what you were doing. Not every situation can we say that about. Right? We won't understand it all until we get to heaven. As old song says, we'll understand it better by and by. But right now, we're not by and by. We're here and here. And it's hard to understand some things. You have it in your mind?
Yes.
That's Habakkuk. You're in chapter 3. Turn back a page or so, maybe even half a page. It depends on how your Bible's laid out. Chapter 1, verse 5. He's asking God a question. He starts out asking God questions. The second word of the book, in verse 1, says, the burden. A burden that he saw. Most prophets saw a vision. Habakkuk saw a burden. That's something hard to bear. That's something God showed him. And he said, I'm not going to just show you what's going to happen. I'm going to make it hard for you to bear. He comes down to verse 5, and God speaks back to him. He says, Behold ye among the heathen, and regard, and wonder marvelously. Here's a verse that everybody loves. They love this part of the verse. For I will work a work in your days which ye will not believe, though it be told you. And everybody looks at that verse and says, oh, Lord, work a work that we wouldn't believe unless you told us. I'm sitting there like, no, don't do that. Please, Lord, not right now. Because that's not a good thing. It's something that Habakkuk looks at and says, Lord, why in the world would you do that? God says, I told you, I'm going to do something that you will not understand. What he was going to show him was, here's God's chosen people, the Israelites. Really, Habakkuk's prophesying about the divided kingdom. You have Israel in the north and Judah in the south. He's talking about Judah. Israel had kings like Ahab. I mean, you talk about a wicked guy, Ahab. He had a wife. She was worse. She wasn't even a Jew. She was a Gentile. Her name was Jezebel. I've never met anybody or anything met Jezebel except one time, and it was a nasty-looking old pit bull. Like you imagine a junkyard dog pit bull, that's what I saw. Torn ear, blind in an eye, limped a little bit, scars all over its body, but it's the kind of dog you don't want to mess with. Her name was Jezebel. And it fits. That's Israel. Judah had some bad kings, but they had some good kings. They had King Josiah. They had Jehoshaphat. They had some good kings. These were, they went astray for a while, but they were better than Israel, the northern kingdom. And God says, I'm going to use wicked, heathen, pagan people from Babylon to capture you and enslave you, to chasten you for your idolatry, for your lack of faith, for your division, for your rebellion. I'm going to use someone worse than you to punish you. That was the work that God was about to do. And he says, I'm about to do a work, and it's going to do something so great, and you won't even believe it unless somebody, even if somebody told you, you won't understand it. That's the work. So be careful taking a verse out of context. Say, oh, Lord, do a work that we can't believe. Oh, that's the verse. And he's saying, I'm about to do something that's going to be really hard for you to understand. You won't understand it. But you're going to have to bear it. And I'm reminded again, in everything, give thanks. He didn't understand what was going to happen. The hard part was why it would happen. But God was going to use wicked people to punish his holy people. I want you to remind you of something. God's ways are not our ways. The Bible says his ways are past finding out. You know, let's just be honest. Take your halo and set it aside. Let's get real for a second. All right? Listen. Wake up for a second. Listen. I haven't even started preaching yet. Some of you are already asleep. Wake up. All right? About 15 minutes, you can fall asleep. If we're honest, there are some situations that would come into our lives that if we had the power to change it, we would change it. We would, really, why we would change it is for our own ease and comfort. Okay? And we would, at that point, if we change what's happening, we would end up changing the result. What would probably happen is it would be easier to go through the situation, but we probably wouldn't like the result as much. We want to change how things go. But I want you to know that when we do that, we're not trusting God the way we should. Can I say that and not offend you? God's ways are past finding out. They are good because God is good.
Amen.
Let me say that again. Some of you need to hear it. God's ways are good because He is good. He is only good. He is always good, and He can be nothing else. Therefore, He can do nothing else. You cannot separate what God does from who God is.
Amen.
You can't separate it. If you did, we would not have God. There we go. That was so good, somebody else had to play it back. I love it. I hate my voice. Anybody else hate your voice, your recording? I hate the sound of my voice. Oh, it's aggravating. I'm sorry you have to hear it. I'm sorry. We can say God's ways are good for two reasons. First of all, because God is good. Second of all, because what He does, the way He does things, fulfill His will and His purpose in our lives. It always fulfills that. When you come to Habakkuk chapter 3, let's look at verse 17. These are the last three verses. Bibles are laid out differently as far as these kinds of things, but in my Bible, I don't know if yours has it, but do you see the number 17 for verse 17? The first word is although.
Yeah.
Do you have a little mark between the number 17, the word although?
Yeah.
Looks like a backwards P with a line next to it.
Yes.
Anybody know what that means? I know you do. Somebody said it. New paragraph. New thought. Change of ideas. A new paragraph. That's the idea. Now, that is not inspired. That is not from God. That's from editors that put that in the Bible, all right? So just so you know, just like verses and chapters, that was added later. But it's accurate because there's a change of thought. Habakkuk had his mind changed about something. Lord, why would you do this? We don't deserve those people to be used to punish us. We don't deserve that. Why don't you use someone better than we are instead of somebody that's worse than us? He says, because I'm going to do a work that you won't believe even if somebody told it to you. You're not going to believe it. So he comes to verse 17. He says, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines. The labor of the olive shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and He will make my feet like hinds' feet. He will make me to walk upon mine high places, to the chief singer on my stringed instruments. I want to bring a message to you entitled, Trust That Produces Thanks. Trust that produces thanks. When you read verse 17, and even before that a little bit, we believe it's probably a vision, the burden that God gave to Habakkuk, a vision of how Babylon would take Judah and how they would become captive to Babylon. We believe that's what it was, and if you want to see more of that, you can read the book of Lamentations. And Jeremiah was a firsthand witness. He was an eyewitness of the destruction of Jerusalem. So he wrote the book of Lamentations, the weeping, the mourning, the lamenting. He talked about some horrible things that took place. I don't have time to go into it. I don't know that it would really enhance what I want to give you anyway, but read the book of Lamentations and this will make a lot more sense. Verse 17 will really come to life if you read Lamentations. When you look at verse 17, talks about a fig tree and fruit, the olives, the fields, the flock, the folds, the empty stalls. Can I tell you, that's not just a bad day. Back then, that was not a bad day. That was death. Death was staring them in the face. But I want you to think about this. Think about a fig tree. Somebody had to plant the fig tree. Somebody had to plant the vine. Somebody had to start a farm and have a herd of animals and had to put them in the stalls and all these different things that took place. Somebody had to do that. But let's be honest, as the Bible says in the New Testament, so one person plants the seed, somebody else waters the seed, but God gives the increase. That's a farming principle. You can ask any farmer, you can know. They'll till the soil, they'll plow it up, they'll disc it, they'll plant it, they'll fertilize it, they'll do everything they can, but they can't make it grow. Only God can do that. There's a real problem. Here's what we try to do. We try to produce things. We try to do things. We try to shape and, excuse me, but we try to manipulate our situation certain ways so that we get what our results should be. But I want you to know that despite the circumstances, despite what you can and cannot produce in your life, no matter what other people do, no matter what the results of their actions are, you can rejoice in the Lord. You can. I want to show you and help us discover how Habakkuk went from chapter 1 to chapter 3, how he went from questioning and doubting and fear to rejoicing. And I want to remind you that the questions and the doubts and the fears did not leave him. Didn't leave him. Look at verse 17. It says, although these things are here. He had to have a recognition of the circumstances. He had to recognize the circumstances. This was not just a bad day. It was a matter of life and death. This was not just a matter of inconvenience. This was beyond their ability to control it or to change it. I want you to know it does no good to ignore the reality of a situation. No lasting good comes from just simply thinking positive about a negative situation. There's no lasting good. It may affect your feelings a little bit, and your emotions may change for a few minutes, but it doesn't change the situation. He had to look at the circumstances and with reality. He had to recognize that these are real things that he could not change. He couldn't do anything about it. They couldn't work harder to change it. They couldn't wish it away. They couldn't pray harder and let it change. That wouldn't fix it. They were in real trouble. There was no quick fix because look at it. The fig tree shall not blossom. No fruit in the vines, so no grapes. The labor of the olive shall fail. The olive was a major, just like the figs, was a major produce in that time, in that area of the world. It still is. They use it for so many things. The fields shall yield no meat. There's no wheat, there's no barley, there's no grain, there's nothing growing. The flock shall be cut off from the herd. The animals are dying, so much so that there's no herd in the stalls. There's nothing to eat. And if anybody knows anything about planting a garden, if you're starving to death and then you plant a garden, you're going to die because it doesn't grow fast enough to feed you. If anybody knows anything about raising animals this way, cows and sheep and goats and those kind of animals, you can try to get, you can get a male and a female together, but if you're starving at that point, you're not going to get their offspring anytime real soon. So I'll just eat them. They're not even there though. The stalls are empty. You don't have time to get any. In other words, what it is if you can start the process of trying to fix this in your own power, but you're still going to fail because everything in here takes time to fix. And you couldn't do it even if you wanted to. Only God could. God's the only one that could change this. But God chose not to. Oh, God is so good, and yes, He's good. But what if you have to live through that? What if everything you try to do fails? What if everything you're doing doesn't work? What if your relationships are not what you want them to be? What if you're not as successful as you think you ought to be? What if you don't get what you want? What if those things do happen to you? What if our country does fall? Can you still say God is good? What if socialism does take over our country? Are you with me?
Yeah.
That's what he's facing. This isn't just a personal matter. This is everybody around him that he knows is going to face this and endure this, and many of them are going to die. Many of them are going to do that. Jeremiah talked about limitations. There would be a mother. There was so much starvation going on that there would be a mother who would take her newborn baby and boil that baby and cannibalize that baby. Let's look at it with reality. He said you could be the richest person in Jerusalem at this time. You could have all the silver and gold. You could be King Solomon in Jerusalem, and it wouldn't matter because you couldn't buy food. Your money's worthless. Our country is not going anywhere except that direction. Look at it with reality. Well, I just want to close my eyes to it and turn it and just ignore it. You're not 2 years old. You're not invisible when you close your eyes. And the problems don't disappear when you close your eyes. They're still there. You still have to deal with them. You have to recognize and see the circumstances as they are. We look at it and say, well, if they just weren't that way, you're not looking at it in reality. You're living in a what-if world. You're living in a fantasy world that will never happen. It will never happen. Look at it with reality. Look at it. Look at the circumstances the way they are. Although, I've underlined the word although in verse 17, and then I've gone to verse 18 and underlined the word yet. Although this is happening, yet. It's kind of like this. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, this know also that in the last days, perilous times will come, difficult, dangerous, hard to deal with times. But verse 14, that's chapter 3, verse 1, chapter 3, verse 14. On my Bible, it's right across the column in my Bible. It says, but continue thou. Know this is going to happen, but. Know that people are going to be this way, but you don't. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. The world may be this way, but you don't have to be. The world may be facing difficulty, but you can be like Habakkuk and said, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. There was a real surrender. You see, in the moments of circumstances that are hard and difficult, in those moments, a spiritual Christian will come to the point of real surrender. A spiritual Christian will come to the point of real surrender when he says, yet I will. Instead of living in doubt and disappointment and disagreement with what God is doing in chapter 1, he made the choice to have faith in God. I want you to think about what I'm about to say. Faith is founded upon facts, not feelings. Faith is founded upon facts, not feelings. Well, I don't feel saved. I sure am glad that my salvation is not based on how I feel today or tomorrow or yesterday or any other time. It's based on the truth of God's word. My faith is not based on how I feel. It's based on the truth, the facts that God gives us. So I want you to take a moment. Here's what Habakkuk had to do. Although the situation is this way, yet I will. I'm making a choice of my own volition, my own decision, my own will. I'm saying this is what I'm going to do. There's a real surrender. Remind yourself of what you know about your God. What do you know about God? Think about it. Don't say it out loud. Just in your mind. What do you know to be true about your God? Would you say that He is never failing? You can talk back now, okay? Some of you are asleep. Some of you are awake. Act like you're awake, all right? Is God never failing?
Yes.
That was sad. Is God always faithful?
Yes.
Is He never failing?
Yes.
That was weaker. Why are you getting weaker on that one? Are you struggling with that? Some of you may be experiencing some failure in your life right now and you're blaming God. Is God always faithful?
Yes.
Some of you need to hear yourself say this, all right? Is He never failing?
Yes.
Is He all wise?
Yes.
Is He all-knowing?
Yes.
Because those are two different things. Is He all-powerful?
Yes.
Is He unchanging and unchangeable?
Yes.
Is He everywhere at the same time?
Yes.
Not just here geographically, but He's also in tomorrow and next week and next year. Yes. Right?
Right.
Is your God holy?
Yes.
Is there anything about God that is not holy?
No.
Is your God good?
Yes.
Is your God love?
Yes.
Is your God loving?
Yes.
Yet I will. Although it's going on, yet I will rejoice. So I just don't know if I can. You're not rejoicing in the, there's no figs and the olives and there's no cattle and the stalls are empty. You're not rejoicing in the circumstances, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. When your faith is in the Lord, surrender is normal. Think about this. People do not surrender to one they do not trust. But once you surrender your desire to God's plan, there's a liberating reality that overwhelms your heart. You start rejoicing in the Savior. There are two words given to us in verse 18. I want you to see these in verse 18. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The word rejoice, which says I will rejoice in the Lord, the word rejoice means I will have victory. I will have triumph. And I want you to know that we have been made in Jesus Christ more than conquerors. That's what the Bible tells us. You're more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. We're more than that. We have victory in and through and with and by Christ. I can have triumph over my emotions. I can have triumph over my feelings. I can have triumph over my circumstance, my perspective of what's going on, because I will rejoice. I will triumph in the Lord. But then he says, I will joy. That's a separate word. I'm not going to illustrate it. I was going to, but I'm not going to do it. The word joy means to jump for joy. Leaping around and jumping for joy. I will triumph in the Lord, and I will jump for joy in the God of my salvation. I want you to know something. God is not diminished at all because of our trials. Our problems don't cause God to diminish whatsoever. We can always rejoice in Him. We have changing circumstances, and here's where it's hard. Change is one thing. Uncontrollable is different. These are uncontrollable situations he's talking about. We all have those in our lives that we can't change. We can't control. We can't do something about it. And in that moment, instead of trying to control it and change it and manipulate it and complain about it, stop and say, I know what's going on around me, but I know something greater. I know that my God is still in control. I know that my God is good. I know that my God is holy. I know that God loves me. I know that He will see me through. I know that Christ is my life. I know that He is my strength. And then all of a sudden, you're going to start noticing something. Something starts changing. Oh, problems are still there. It doesn't change out here. It changes in here. You can rejoice in your God and give Him thanks in all things. In all things. And when you start doing that, you're going to rejoice in your Savior. You're going to experience a renewed strength. Look at verse 19. The Lord. The Lord God. Let me tell you what I've been telling you on Wednesday night. Look at these names. I studied this for the past 2-3 weeks, and I'm just now noticing this. Maybe I just forgot it and didn't write it down. Jehovah God, the Lord, all capital letters in Lord, Jehovah. I won't take time to go through all this, but Jehovah in the Old Testament is Jesus in the New. The Lord God, Jehovah Adonai, the covenant keeper, the promise keeping God, the same one who is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Psalm 23:1. The same one, same name. God, excuse me, I said Adonai, Elohim, in the beginning, God created. The one who keeps promises. The one who created the entire world. He's my strength. He is my strength. Oh, here's what we do. We look at it and say, no. I know the Lord is my strength, and I get that, and I'm thankful for it. But we don't live like it until we get His blessings. So what we're saying is, the blessings of the Lord God, those are my strength. On Thanksgiving Day, when I sit down and have all the family and I have all the food, oh, Lord, your blessings are so bountiful. The Lord God is your strength. He himself is your strength. The strength, if you look back at verse 17, the strength was not found in the flocks or the figs or the fields or the fruit, but in the Lord. I have marked in my Bible, in verse 18, I will rejoice. I will. And then verse 19, the Lord God is my strength and He will. I will and He will. He will what? He will make my feet like hinds' feet. And He will make me to walk upon mine high places. Hinds' feet. It's like a deer running and prancing through the woods. Now some of you have been doing that lately. Some of our men are still out doing that. This morning. But they're out there, and their goal is to see a deer not running but standing still. And if it's running, they're going to make some really weird noises like an animal to try to make it stop, and then we'll stop it. Hinds' feet. It's the picture of joy and rejoicing as a deer that would leap and run, jumping over fallen trees and maybe a fence, or maybe just running and jumping freely, lightly. He says, you'll make my feet like hinds' feet. That goes back to I will joy in the God of my salvation. When I start taking my joy in the God of my salvation, then He does something to my feet. They're not just dragging along in life. I'm just going to muddle my way through all this. I can't. No. When you start taking joy in the God of your salvation, He makes them light. He puts a skip in your step. He gives you joy. He starts making it lighter. He helps you rejoice. Remember that word joy means to jump for joy. And He says, I'm going to do that because He's going to make my feet like hinds feet, just jumping over everything, just running through the woods. Some of you need that this morning. Some of you say, I need the Lord to make my feet like hinds feet. You don't know the problems I'm facing. Realize your problem is real. Recognize the reality of your circumstances. And then surrender your will to God. Yet I will. Even though this is going on, I will. I'm going to make a volitional choice. I'm going to decide on my own will. I will. It's not going to stop me. I'm still going to do this. I'm still going to rejoice in my Savior. And as you're rejoicing and as you're doing that, your strength is going to be renewed. I choose to rejoice in the Lord, and He makes my feet to leap for joy. It says He causes me to walk in my high places. You ever, maybe I'm going to say something I hope you can relate to. You ever feel like you're in the valley? But you still have the peace and the comfort and the joy and the grace of God, so you feel like you're on the mountain. That's what He's saying. My circumstances didn't change. My situations are still really hard. But when I start rejoicing in the God of my salvation, I joy in Him and I leap for joy. And that idea of joy and leaping for joy, jumping for joy, is the idea of I'm praising Him. I am thanking Him. I'm rejoicing. Not, look, where are God's blessings in verse 17? What we would call blessings. Not there. They're not there. Say, well, it's a blessing that I'm starving. It's a blessing that I don't have any money or any way to get money. I have nothing. I am going to die a horrible, painful, terrible death. Lord, thank you for your blessings. When you can't thank God for His blessings, thank Him for Him, for who He is. The joy. Get this truth, if you would. I'm trying to give you one great truth under each one. Now I want you to get this. What we rejoice in is our strength. That's where we get our strength from, is what we rejoice in. What you find joy in, that's where you get your strength. So what is the source of your joy? If it's people, you're going to be disappointed. They're going to let you down. If it's in yourself, you're going to let yourself down. If it's in a job or an ability or a gift or talent, who knows, you may not have that much longer. I'm not saying you were going to lose it, but who knows how long you'll have that. Some of you know right now at this point in your life, the talents and things you used to be able to do, you just can't. You just can't. So if that's what you're finding your joy in, and then after a while it's gone, then you have no strength. Because what you joy in is where you're going to find your strength. I know people, and this is so sad, I've seen it so many times. I've seen parents, mom and dad, find their joy in their children and nobody else. And then the children grow up and they move out. I can't tell you how many times I've seen people been married for 30, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45 years. Divorce. There's no strength left. And I don't think it's not just because of what they did with their kids. I don't think that's even the primary issue. But if you look at it, you think, man, all they care about is their kids. I mean, that's it. They don't care about their marriage. They don't care about the Lord. They don't care about anything else. It's just their kids, their kids, their kids, their kids, their kids, their kids. Then their kids are gone. I know of one lady, I know of one woman, she's no longer living because after her kids were gone, she had no purpose for living. Gone. What I'm trying to say is, you will find your strength in what you rejoice in. So what's the source of your joy? That is where your strength comes from. Strength comes from joy, and our joy comes from the Lord. Nehemiah chapter 8 says, the joy of the Lord is our strength. I want you to know, when you're overwhelmed, you don't think you can go on, you can start rejoicing in your Savior, and He will renew your strength. He may not change your circumstances, but you're going to feel stronger. Habakkuk grew. He went from chapter 1 to chapter 3. Didn't take that long. It doesn't cover a lot of time. But chapter 1, I don't like what you're doing, God. I don't understand what you're doing or why you're doing it this way. Chapter 3, he says this, I don't have to know what you're doing. I don't have to know why you're doing it. Because who I know is greater than what I don't know. I know God. I may not know what He's doing or why He's doing it this way, but I know Him, therefore I trust Him. And because I trust Him, I surrender myself to Him, because He can only do good. His purposes are holy, and He will accomplish His holy, good purpose in my life. Rejoice in who He is. It says, I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. I will rejoice in the Lord. It does not say, I will rejoice in the blessings of the Lord. But I will rejoice in the Lord Himself. Let me remind you, verse 17. All those problems that he gives there, out of man's control. Out of his hands. He couldn't control it. You know, it's real easy to be thankful when everything we do is successful. It's real easy to say, thank you, Lord, for your abundant blessings. Well, we're having them poured all over us, and everything's good, and all makes sense, and everything's just fine. What that means is everything's going the way I think it should. That's all that means. That's all that means. When everything's good, it means it's going the way I think it should. And I have all so many blessings, that means I'm comfortable. It's true. But what about when you're not comfortable? What about when it's hard and it doesn't make sense? And things are not in the timing you want, when you don't understand and things are really tough? Somebody once said, when you can't see His hand, trust His heart. When you don't understand His purposes, stand on His promises. When you can't see what God is doing, you can always trust His character. And you can rejoice in the Lord. This Thanksgiving season, in the month of November, as you're getting ready for those kinds of things, praise God for His blessings. Amen. But thank God for who He is before you thank Him for His blessings. Heavenly Father, thank You for being You. All that You are is all that You will ever be. And it's all You have ever been, because You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You do not change. And I thank You that based on that truth of Your immutability, we can be consistent. We can stand strong and firm and full of faith in Your truths and Your promises because of who You are. Lord, right now in this moment, I pray that You would help us each one to say yes to You as You speak to us. Before I finish my prayer, with every head bowed, every eye closed, I wonder who is here today that would be able to lift your hand as a testimony thanking God that you know the Lord Jesus Christ is your personal Savior. You know you're saved. Your sin is forgiven. Heaven is your home. You know that for sure. No doubt about it. If that's you, would you be able to lift your hand as a testimony to that fact? I know I'm saved. I know I'm going to heaven. Keep it up big and high. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not trying to embarrass anybody. Let's just be honest. Thank you. You can lower your hands. Thank you. How many of you would say, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't want to lie. I'm just not sure. I'd like to know I'm going to heaven, but I'm not sure of that. Just not sure of it. But I want to be sure of it. If that would be your situation right now, I want you to do me a favor. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to do something that would make you feel awkward, I promise you. But I do promise that I will pray for you. And I do promise I want to give you an opportunity. If you want to be sure of it, I want to give you an opportunity to make sure of it today. You can. Say, Pastor, please pray for me. I do not know for sure heaven is my home. But I want to know that. Please pray for me. Here's my hand. Would you be able to lift your hand up in the air for just a moment? Say, Pastor, please pray for me. I do not know heaven's my home. Thank you. Thank you. You can lower your hand. Thank you. Thank you for your honesty. Is there anybody else? I won't embarrass you. I promise. I promise I'm going to pray for you. If I don't know you, God knows you. He knows you. Here's the great thing. God knows you, but I want you to know him. God created you. He made you. And he made heaven. And God made a way and provided a way for you, his creation, to get to heaven where he lives. We would like to show you that today. I typically try to include that in my message every time. Today I was not able to make it flow easily. It'd be really awkward to just switch gears on it. But I want you to know something. I want you to listen carefully. If you raise your hand, I'm not going to embarrass you, but I want you to know God loves you right where you're at. I may not know your background. I don't know all that you're going through in life, but God does, and he still loves you. I don't know all that you've done, but God still loves you, and he knows that. I want you to understand that. There is a problem. That problem is not with God. The problem is with us. The Bible says, Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have sinned. A sin is something that you do that breaks God's law. We've all done that. I don't think anybody in this room would say, I am completely perfect. I don't think anybody would say that. We've all sinned and messed up, haven't we? Would you agree with that? Yeah, I have. That's no doubt about that. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The problem with that is this. Say, well, it's not that big of a deal. I may have sinned, but I'm really not that bad of a sinner. It doesn't matter how good you are at sinning or how bad you are at sinning. The fact is, we're all sinners. So, the problem with that is this. Your sin has to be paid for. The Bible says the wages of sin, Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. But the good news is this. The great news is Jesus Christ died on the cross for you. He was buried and he rose again from the dead so you could have eternal life. That's what the Bible says, Romans chapter 5 and verse 8. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Say, why did Jesus die? Because the payment, the wages of sin is death. And he said, I'm going to die for you so that you can have eternal life. All you have to do is personally trust God to forgive you of your sin based on what Jesus Christ did on the cross and his resurrection. It's that simple. When I was 8 years old, I trusted Christ as my Savior. Not everybody does it when they're a child. Some people do it right before they die. But I got saved. I became a Christian and trust Christ as my Savior when I was an 8-year-old boy. I didn't understand all of it, but I understood that God loves me, that I was a sinner. My sin had to be paid for. Jesus paid for my sin. And all I have to do is trust his work on the cross, trust him alone, nothing else. And I asked him to personally be my Savior and forgive me of my sin. And he did. That was a long time ago. I know I'm saved and on my way to heaven, not because of what I do or if I'm good or bad, but because Jesus died on the cross for me and I trusted that for forgiveness of my sin. That's what the Bible teaches. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. You can't get to heaven except through Jesus. The good thing is, anybody can go through Jesus. That includes you sitting here right now. I want you to think about that for just a moment. How many here today would say, Pastor, I know I'm saved, but quite honestly, there's some things going on in my life, and I've been struggling, rejoicing in the God of my salvation. I've had a hard time rejoicing in the Lord because, quite honestly, my circumstances have been kind of rough. There's nothing wrong with admitting hard circumstances and difficult times. There's nothing wrong with that. We have to look at it as reality. You say, God has spoken to me today and he's shown me I need to rejoice in him. Today I make the choice by faith that I will, although this is happening, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. God's shown you that, and you need help with that today. Why don't you lift your hand? Let me pray for you today. Would you lift your hand big and high in the air for just a moment? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. If you raised your hand just now, that you need to rejoice in the God of your salvation, you need to rejoice in the Lord despite of, in the midst of, your circumstances, I'm going to invite you to come to the Lord, pour out your heart to him, and tell him, Lord, by your strength, with your help, by your grace, I will rejoice in you. But here's the great thing about a church like this. We don't want you to be left alone to that. We want to encourage you with it. So if you feel led to and you're comfortable with this, I want to ask you to do something. I'm going to invite you in just a moment. We're going to stand to our feet. And I'm going to invite you that raise your hand saying that God's shown you that you need to rejoice in the Lord in spite of your circumstances. If you would like someone to pray with you about that, and just put their arm around you and say, I love you. I love you in the Lord. I want to pray with you and I want to encourage you today. I want to invite you, don't come up here. I want you to go to the back where men and women back there that are already ready. They're waiting right now where if you stood up and walked back there, they want to greet you. And if you know them, they're your friends, your brothers and sisters in Christ. They can pray with you. They can show you these things just to encourage you. We all need that at some point. That's a good thing. If you raised your hand a moment ago saying, I don't know for sure heaven's my home, but I do want to know that for sure. I don't know I'm going to heaven, but I can tell you right now, I don't want to die and go to hell, but I don't know I'm going to heaven. And I want to make sure of that today. I'm going to give you the same opportunity. I want to invite you in just a moment when we stand. I want to invite you, don't come up here. I want you to step out and move towards the back. There are men and there are women back there. They are eager. They're excited. They would love to take just a few minutes and show you from the Bible how you can know heaven is your eternal home, how Jesus Christ can be your Savior, how your sins can be forgiven. You can be made a new creature in Christ today. It's not a scary thing. It's a happy, rejoicing thing. In just a moment, we're going to stand. I want to invite you, if that's you, to walk to the back, and they'll greet you back there and pray with you. Heavenly Father, in this moment of invitation, I pray that we would be yielded and obedient to what your Holy Spirit has done in our spirit right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand to our feet, if you would, please. God has spoken to you. Why don't you move right now? Just step out, go right back there. No one's, our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. We're not going to make a big public scene about this. But maybe just step out and go. Just step out and go. Step out and go. When I say step out, I mean just literally step out of the aisle, and I guarantee you someone will help you. Why don't you do it? Why don't you do it? Let people pray with you. Let them help you. Let them help you. Sometimes all people need is just a little nudge. Just a little nudge. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your good work in our lives and our service today. Lord, my sincere prayer would be that every decision that's made here today would not just be some emotional feeling that overwhelms us, but the truth of the Word of God, guided into our hearts and our spirit by the Holy Spirit, would bear fruit and that we would see a great change in each one of us. Lord, I thank you that I can rejoice in the God of my salvation, that I can triumph and have victory because of who you are, not because of who I am. Lord, I love you and I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
All right, at this time, we're going to be looking at our announcements real quick. I wanted to first start off with tempting your mind and your stomach, okay? I know we're all hungry, ready to go get something to eat, but I wanted to read something off to you. Boston cream pie.
Whoa.
Strawberry cake, pound cake, a pie. We got cookies and cupcakes. We got red velvet cake, coconut cake, pecan pie, German chocolate cake, banana pudding, all other types of assortment things that we'll end up growing this week. We're having a bake sale next Sunday. And I hope you guys just remember all those things. Just let your mouth just water right now. Because we want you guys to come back next Sunday night and be a part of this bake auction. And last year was very successful. We had all kinds of cakes and pies and cookies and everything up here. We had one really cool dude, the auctioneer. I don't know what he's planning to do this year, but whatever it is, it'll be a blessing. And everything that we do here at our church, it all goes through the Great Commission.
Yes.
And not only that, you're supporting the Great Commission, but you also get to take that home with you and enjoy it for your belly, right? So it's a double whammy. So be a part of that next Sunday evening right after the service. And we do need some more people to sign up. There's about 15 people now that signed up. And we definitely would encourage you guys to do that. There is a sign-up sheet in the back that will list of what you want to bring. Other than that, all is welcome here to, obviously, to be at our church, but for that bake auction as well. Anybody can bid. And I know everybody would have a wonderful time. Also, that is part of the Young at Heart missions that we have here at our church that they have. But December 9th is the Young at Heart Christmas party. There's a sign-up sheet in the back for that as well. But those are for people 60 or older to be a part of. So please go ahead and start signing up for that. Ladies Night Out, Taste of Christmas. We have a special speaker, Carly Forrest. And there is a sign-up sheet in the back. It's
$5 if you pay by December 3rd, and $10 or costs is after that's $10. So if you want to go ahead and sign up for that, there is a sign-up sheet in the back as well. I know the teens, they're going out right after church today. They're going to go play top golf and have some lunch. So if you're a teen and you're just now hearing about it, the cost is $15 if you want to go this right after church today. And then just remember, during the week of Thanksgiving, there is no Wednesday night service. But just remember, you know, to be here in your place, you know, the church service that we do have. We have holidays coming up, Thanksgiving and Christmas. There are a little bit of things not scheduled as normal, but try to be here. Try to be here, and you know you'll grow in your faith, be strengthened by God, and you'll learn you know, something new. You know, you'll be changed as you come in here and as you leave. Remember our services tonight at 6 o'clock, and our Wednesday night service tonight, or Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Gentlemen, can we go ahead and get ready for the offering, please? There is also another thing on here, coins for Christmas. Normally, you would see in the back there a car that you could put quarters in. They usually do this around Christmas time here. But now there's envelopes that you could put whatever that you want in there, whatever amount. Usually that coins for Christmas is adds up to about $5. But, you know, it's a little bit easier to do the envelope. And you can give less, you can give more than what you gave last year if you want to be a blessing to them. All right, let's go ahead and do our offering here. Brother Malin, if you would, could you bless the offering, please?
Dear Lord, I thank you for today that you give us. I do pray, Father, that you bless each and every one of us that come out today. Bless the ones that couldn't be here, Lord. I pray, Father, that you let them know that we miss them and we'd like to see them here. And Lord, I do pray, Father, that you'd bless this offering, use it for your honor and your glory. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Fairly soon. I'm going to try to greet a few people at the back, so just give me a little bit of time there if you would, but we'll be heading out soon to Topgolf, and
food somewhere. We'll see. Sam's Club has really good hot dogs. Seriously, where's Miss Faye? Miss Faye, your brother, is Brother Phil here?
He's sitting outside.
Okay, good. There's Brother Phil. Oh my goodness. I'm sorry, Brother Phil. Brother Rex was in front of you. I'm gonna blame Brother Rex. No, I get it. Brother Phil and Miss Faye, before the McPhersons moved, they were overworking at the house and different things, and they were working, and they said, the McPherson said, we're gonna take you out to eat somewhere. He said, we're gonna take you to our favorite restaurant. Took him to Sam's Club and got him a hot dog. I like it. My kids love it, and I'm thankful they love it, because I can get out of there for $1.40, $1.50 a kid, so that's a blessing. But anyway, we won't go to Sam's Club. We'll go somewhere else better than that, all right? But not too expensive. But give me some time. We'll be back there. I'll give you some instructions. If you're going, you're a teenager, want to go, we're back in my office, latch door on the right nose hallway, and we'll exchange money and get ready to go with it all. Rick, Brother Bill's doing this. I don't want to embarrass the guy, Brother Bill. Too late now.
He told me I'm too late.
Oh, did he really? Well, then.
Praise the Lord.
Wonderful. I'm sorry?
Nathaniel.
Nathaniel, I don't want to embarrass you, but he's already done it, so I can't do any worse than what he just did, all right? Can I ask you real quick, what did you ask the Lord to do for you just a few moments ago? To save you?
Amen.
Did he forgive you of your sin? Did he save you? If you were to die today, we don't want that to happen, but if you were to die today, do you know where you would go?
Yes.
You'd go to heaven. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We are happy to know. Nathaniel, please don't leave too fast. Give me a moment. I'm going to walk back there while we're praying, so don't just chew down. I'm going to see you real quick, okay? All right. Let's bow for prayer. We'll be back tonight. Brother Rex Richards will be preaching. I want to say thank you publicly for him for taking the pulpit on Sunday nights. It's been a blessing not just to hear him. I enjoy hearing him, but it's also been a help to me as we work on the building to not have to put so much more time, another 12, 13 hours into the sermon for Sunday night. So thank you, Brother Rex, for doing that. I appreciate it. I'm honored. We pray for Miss Nina Foltz. I have a list. I forgot to look at it. My bulletin's folded the wrong way. We pray for Miss Nina Foltz and her whole family. Her sister, Dixie, Thursday evening, I believe it was, passed away down in Florida and in her early 40s. So we pray for Dixie's family and all of that. This is Miss Nina's older sister. We pray for them. I did not do this, and I feel absolutely horrible. I feel absolutely horrible for not doing this. I hate to make that an afterthought, but it's better than not doing it at all. Yesterday was Veterans Day, and I did not recognize and honor our veterans today. I usually have you stand and all that stuff, and I didn't. I'm publicly asking for your forgiveness on that, because that's very important to me. And I was thinking about Nathaniel getting saved, and I was thinking about some other things in the service, and it just, I left it, and I'm sorry. Let me do this. I'm not going to take the time to go around because it's going to be hard to see in here right now. But let me ask you, how many of you have served in our armed forces, our military? Would you raise your hand, please? High enough where we could see it. There we go. Now, I can't see anybody except Brother Paul. I'm kidding. Big and high again so I can see. Brother Paul, Brother Phil, Brother Charlie, Brother Will. There's somebody else I can't see back there. What's your name, sir? I'm sorry?
Heath.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I didn't hear you either. Heath. Thank you. Was there anybody else I didn't get? Yes, I miss your brother Will Rogers. Yes. I want to say thank you. I think it was all men. Gentlemen, I want to say thank you for your service to our country. And we are American because of God's blessing, but we're also free today, a lot of it, because of people like you.
Yes.
And I honor you for that, and I thank you for your service. I was never in the service. I was never in the military. I had family that was. I have my wife's family. Many of them were in Army and Marines. I had an uncle that was an Army Ranger and other ranges that way, Air Force and all this. And I will say thank you. I'm honored to have you here and to call you my brothers in Christ and for your service to our country. Thank you. I'm sorry I did not recognize you earlier. I apologize for that. today. But it's been a good day anyway.
Amen.
Excited about Nathaniel. What a blessing.
Amen.
Let's pray. Ask God to bless. Pray for Messina and her family with the passing of her sister, if you would. All right. I'm looking here. Brother Rex Richards, would you mind, sir, pray for us and God bless us?
Father, we are so thankful that we can rejoice in you today. Thank you, Lord, that I had a young man who wanted to receive you as their personal Savior today. We certainly thank you for that. Remind us, Lord, when troubles come and situations that we don't understand. Help us to rejoice in you, that our joy might be full. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done today. Give us a good day. Return with us back tonight. And may we glorify you in Jesus' name.
I have two things.